So clearly we need a bigger room. That's more next time. So on behalf of the College of Sciences and the College of Engineering, so I'm pleased to welcome a very distinguished guest today, so Professor Adam, Cat University Electrical and Electronics Engineering Department. So just a few words of introduction from my side. I'm definitely not the most qualified person in this room to be making this introduction, but I got some help from my colleagues. So Professor Arakan's contributions lie in the heart of what's called information theory. So information theory is a field that was really established by one single person called Shannon after the Second World War. So in the 40s, starting from the 40s and so on. Shannon not only laid out the mathematical foundations of how information is transmitted from one point to the other, but also established a number of fundamental quantities and bounds on things like, for instance, what is the maximum rate at which you can transmit information over a communication channel which is subject to errors or noise. So for the next 50, 60 years or so in information theory, many smart people, scientists, engineers, and so on, were chasing Shannon bound, so trying to come up with coding schemes that were approximations to the bounds and so on. Okay? So until recently, when Professor Arakan showed that there was a particular coding scheme called polar codes that were in fact achieving the Shannon bound. So very major scientific contribution. It's very, I think, elegant and beautiful in terms of the math and science. But also, I'm even less qualified to talk about the technological side, but also has big impact in telecommunications. Just to let you know that I think in the next generation of mobile networks, the 5G networks, polar codes will be used in the implementation, and probably for the next generation after that, 6G and 7G and so on. Okay, so let me stop here with a short bio. So Professor Arakan has a PhD from MIT. He's been at BCAT for a long time now. So for his work and achievements, he's the recipient of several awards. Just citing a few, the most recent ones, the IEEE Baker Award, and then the IEEE Hanning Award in recent years. And most recently, he was announced to be the recipient of the 2019 Claude Shannon Award. So it's a pleasure to have Professor Arakan here.
Thank you very much. I'm very happy to be and honored to be here. And excited to be talking to this big crowd of students. And I'm very honored.
No, he can't hear you.
There is no problem. Is there a volume control? Can't do this. Okay. Much better. Okay. So let me begin by expressing my thanks for the invitation. And as I said, it's my second time here at Koch University. Always a pleasure to be here. The first time, I think it was in 2005, through the TV project. Yep, right. So the title of my talk is Information Theory and Polar Coding. So you already had a very informative and correct introduction to what I'm going to be talking about. So let me first begin by giving an outline of the talk. So you have a roadmap, and at least take away a couple of in advance what I'm going to talk about. So the problem that I'm going to talk about is reliable transmission of information over noisy communication channels. And the solution to this problem is an array of algorithms that we call channel coding. Polar coding, the subject of this talk, the main subject, is one of those algorithms. It's a channel coding algorithm. So there's a theory behind all of this. Most important is there is Claude Shannon's channel coding theorem. I will talk about this one in the first part of my talk. And then I will talk about channel polarization and polar coding. So let's begin. Claude Shannon, he was a mathematician and theoretical engineer. He is the founder of information theory. And he is, you may consider him as the what Newton is to mechanics. Claude Shannon is to information theory. Prior to Shannon, it is kind of surprising that nobody really thought in depth about what information is. So he was the first one to ask this question. Maybe not the first one to ask this question, but the first one to provide an answer. And information is not really what we think it is. In everyday life, we use information as something meaningful. I tell you a story, and if there is some meaning, we can gain some information, etc. But in communications engineering, information is used in a technical sense. So it is a choice out of an ensemble of choices. And what we want to do by informing, information means transmission of information, means that we send from an origin to a destination what choice we have made, such as flipping a coin and letting another person at the destination know what the outcome of the experiment was. So Shannon, perhaps more importantly, Shannon gave us a measure of information. So he treated information as a physical quantity such as mass or energy. I'm going to substantiate this in the next slide. And then he defined information theory. These are from the 14th edition of Encyclopedia Britannica. He defined information theory as the discovery of mathematical laws governing systems designed to communicate or manipulate information. So this is a very broad definition. It goes far beyond, in fact, communication systems, but it includes many other things that we do with information and data. So information theory, he says, sets up quantitative measures of information and of the capacity of various systems to transmit, store, and otherwise process information. So I would be happy if I can get across one or two of these ideas and make them clear in your mind. So he says information can be thought of as a physical quantity, much like energy and mass. Here's an analogy to explain this. So let's say we have cargo produced or coming to a port at the rate of r tons per day. We have a unit for it. And then there are ships which carry this cargo, and they have a capacity of c tons per day. You may think of c as the capacity of the port or harbor as well. So those goods that are brought to the port cannot be carried, obviously, if the rate of arrival of the goods or containers is greater than the capacity of the port. This is kind of obvious. We take this as something quite obvious. So something similar is also true in communications. If information is arriving at a rate greater than the capacity of a channel, communication channel, there is no way you can communicate it reliably, send it reliably to the destination. So the question that comes up here is, we measured the amount of cargo by tons per day or cubic meters per day and so on. We can find a measure for it. What is the correct measure of information? How do you measure how much information there is, let's say, in a message? And this one, we have a ship here, and it has a certain capacity. So given a communication channel, what is the capacity of the channel? How much information can it carry? So Shannon theory, information theory, first and foremost gives us formulas for calculating how much information there is in a message or a message ensemble, and calculating the capacity of communication channels. So these are totally new. Prior to Shannon, we had no idea how to do either of these. That measure is called the entropy, and this one is called the channel capacity. So he gave us formulas for calculating the amount of information and the capacity of communication channels to carry information. Both of them are expressed by the same units, just like R tons per day and C tons per day. They have to have the same units so that you can compare them. If R is greater than C, it's an impossible task. Otherwise, it may or may not be possible. If R is less than C, that doesn't mean that you'll be able to carry it. For the following reason, there may be volume constraints. We are measuring the cargo by tons per day, so some of them may contain light material and so on. So it is not guaranteed that you'll be able to carry it here. So this corresponds to messages having some redundancies, just like the containers may have some empty spaces in it, so that you would not be able to fit all the containers on a ship, just because this not only has a capacity in terms of tons per day, but also a volume constraint. So this analogy is taken from Shannon's Encyclopedia Britannica article as well, is a sound one. But it is not a total one. In other words, you cannot really think of information just like a commodity. There are some subtleties, but I think it gives us some feeling for what Shannon had in mind. So he was looking for how do I measure the amount of information and how do I compute the capacity of channels. So being more formal, Shannon put down, and there are many lessons to be drawn from Claude Shannon's work. So he had a technique, a method for dealing with problems. Information theory is not only important, but Shannon's style of research is also as important. So here is his way of looking at it. First, he lays out the problem very clearly. Shannon's communication system model, it has a source. Okay, so this is like the goods that you want to transport from one location to another, from China to Istanbul, let's say. Now, they cannot be transported immediately. There is this. This is the channel, the transatlantic carriers, etc., the cargo ships. But before you can pack the information into send it through the channel, you need to process it. Just like you would pack the goods and put them in a container. This is usually a physical channel. The input may be an electrical signal. The input may be an optical signal. And information is something quite abstract. So you need to turn the information into a physical form that can be carried by the channel. That's what the transmitter is about. And at the receiver side, you have to undo what you have done onto the information. You have to extract the information from the carrier, unloading the containers and opening the containers, etc., etc. And finally, there is a destination. So the goal of the system is to carry the information without any error, loss, etc., to the destination. And the channel is noisy. So some of those ships on the way from China to here may sink or may get destroyed, etc., may get lost. So despite this, you would like to somehow be able to send here the information. Okay, so this is the problem. The fundamental problem of communication is that of reproducing at one point, at the destination point, either exactly or approximately, a message selected at another point. One of the key words here is selected at another point. Okay, let's be a little more concrete. Every day we are sending or receiving data. There is a bit sequence we sent to a faraway place, or we are receiving it. And occasionally there will be some errors in the transmission. This is unavoidable. So some of the zeros that we sent will be received as one. And in many applications, such as bank transactions, file transfers, such errors are not tolerable. So you have to locate the errors and correct them. So this is the channel coding problem, the primary problem that Shannon dealt with. Can we locate and correct the errors that occur because of noise in the communication channel? Let me give you an example that shows this can be done. So you have, let's say, 4 bits. This is your message. And then you provide some redundancy against the noise. Instead of sending the messages directly, you repeat them, let's say, 3 times. A zero is transmitted as 3 zeros, a one is transmitted as 3 ones, and so on. And in the channel, if there are no errors occurring, you are, the receiver will be looking at this on 3 zeros and will be decoding it as a zero. Okay, so the code book here has all the 2 code words. Zero is encoded into the code word 000, and the one as a message is encoded into a code word which consists of 3 ones. By the way, I put the commas here just for visual clarity. In the transmission, there are no commas. So the second one is encoded into 3 ones, but then there is an error in the transmission. So by looking at this one, 101, it is not a code word. How would you decide? Would you decide that this was a zero or a one? Why?
Majority.
Yeah, majority. So implicitly here, we are assuming that the probability of that the channel inverts a bit is less than 1/2. Okay, so that's a reasonable assumption. So you go with the majority decision rule and decode this correctly. And then you will also decode that one correctly. How about this one? This one would be decoded as a one, and that would be an error because we are sending a zero, but the decision would be one. I forgot to put that one here. So this is a simple code. It can correct any single errors in the transmission, but at a cost, at a significant cost. What is the cost? So the cost is if our transmission speed has been cut by a factor of 1/3. So if you were storing data against corruption in memory, you have 1 terabyte of data, think about it like this. Instead of 1 terabyte of hardware, you would have to use 3 terabytes of hardware. It is very costly, okay? But it is showing that errors may be located and corrected. On the other hand, you know, a person like Shannon would ask the following question. This is a trivial observation, of course. What is the limit of this slowdown? What is the best that we can do in terms of error correction? Okay, so there are smarter things that one can do. There is also Hamming codes, parity check codes. This is a code which can also correct single errors, and it can do so more efficiently. So in this case, the data consists of 4 bits. and this is the raw data. The covert is obtained by computing three derivatives and appending them to the data. So this is now the covert consisting of 7 bits. And this code also can correct any single errors during the transmission. And it is more efficient. Instead of slowing down the rate of transmission by a factor of 3, it slows it down only by 4/7. So I can explain to you why it can correct any single error. Let me attempt doing it. So let's say this is our code. This is the bit sequence that we are sending through the channel. So what we do at the receiver is we recompute those parities. Okay, so if, for example, the first bit, D1, is inverted in the channel, the recomputed parity, P1, at the channel is not going to be satisfied. So you will receive as P1, let's say 0, but when you recompute the parity P1 at the destination, it is going to be 1, because one of the bits that enter into the first parity has been inverted. So this is parity number 1. It is the modulo 2 sum of D1, D2, and D4. If any of those 4 bits is inverted in the channel, we will no longer have a consistent parity check. So I don't want to spend too much time in explaining this, but this code here is a single error correcting code which has been used in the memories of the time in 1948 or so. The important thing in here is the following. Maybe that's worth mentioning. If we are transporting commodities, containers, etc., looks like, you know, you can only repeat it. So if you are going to send, let's say, a car from one point to another, and you want to protect this car against loss or damage, etc., during transportation, if you use a repetition code, the corresponding thing is you send 3 cars instead of 1, or you send 2 cars. If one of them gets lost, you receive the other one. Okay? There's a spare, in other words, that you send. Now, with information, there is something that we are doing here, which it's not clear if we can do with ordinary commodities. We are computing the superposition of bits here. These are information. Each is a bit containing, let's say, 1 bit of information. By computing the modulo 2 sum of them, we compute another bit. So is there a counterpart of this one? If you think about, you know, ordinary materials such as chairs, tables, or carts, and so on. Okay, so this is something which goes kind of behind or beyond ordinary commodity transportation. This is an advantage. And this computing parities is the main tool, the main technique that we use in constructing error correcting codes. What we are doing is we are providing redundancy. These bits, the parity bits, are redundant in the sense that they are computed as functions of the raw data. So that's another point. In order to be able to correct errors in transmission, you have to send redundant bits, redundant data, in the form of parity bits or otherwise. This really is the key to any kind of error correction coding algorithm. And the channel coding problem is essentially the following. How small can I make the percentage of redundant bits to the payload? I have 4 bits, I add 3 redundant bits, I have a code of efficiency 4/7, which can correct a single error. So you ask yourself the following question. Can I add just 2 parities to correct a single error? Okay, so coding theory people deal with this problem. What is the smallest number of parities for a given number of data bits that will enable you to correct single errors, for example? and you may go beyond it. You may ask the following question. If I have 10 data bits and I want to correct 2 transmission errors, what is the smallest number of parity bits that I need to append to the data? This is error correction coding, the discipline of error correction coding, and it emanates from Heming's work in 1948, etc. It's an ongoing effort, of course. There are many codes, open source codes, work on much longer data. Often, typically, the number of data bits that you encode is in the hundreds, thousands, etc. So the larger the block of raw data bits, the more powerful you can make these codes. But the more complex the code also becomes. And design of good error correcting codes is a non-trivial subject, to say the least. So block coding, I have said, made some of these points. So what we mean by block coding is we will have a number of data bits, raw data bits. This is the carbon. Okay, on the road there may be accidents. So we are going to compute some redundant bits. And in fact, we don't need to send these transparently. Okay, so we are going to transform them into another word. We call this a code word, corresponding to the data word. So there are k raw data bits here, and we are going to put some redundancy. So we are going to send n bits. N is going to be larger than k. N minus k is the number of redundant bits. The name of the game is to make the rate r, which is the efficiency, k over n, as small as possible for a given error correction capability of the code. Okay, so it's a design problem, in other words. And Shannon's work shows that using such algorithms using parity check codes, etc., block codes, one can achieve the capacity of the channel. So I haven't yet told you what the capacity of a channel is. Okay, so that's Shannon's other main achievement. He gives us a formula for computing the capacity of a channel. So in this talk, you will see often this diagram. Let me explain what that means. This represents a communication channel, W. W is a transition matrix. We will see it. Let's see it. So for a binary input channel, there is an input here, and that takes values either 0 or 1 from the input alphabet. We, in other words, can send only a 0 or 1, and then there is a channel output alphabet here. That can be anything, basically. It can be anything. We will see 2 examples. And W is the transition probability. You send an X, what is the probability that you receive a Y in the output alphabet? Let's be more concrete. Here is an example of a binary input channel. This is called a binary symmetric channel. You can send either a 0 or 1 through this channel. And the output is also either 0 or 1. But with probability epsilon, you receive the opposite bit. You send a 0 with probability 1 minus epsilon, you receive the same thing, no error. But with probability epsilon, the channel inverts the bit that you transmitted due to noise in the channel. Epsilon is some number which you may think of as small, but it is non-zero. Now, if epsilon is 0, the communication problem entirely disappears. If you send a 0 and you always receive a 0, you can just send the bits uncoded. It's important to realize this. There is no need for coding. On the other hand, look at the other extreme too. If epsilon is 1/2, what happens? Let's say you receive a 0. What is the probability that this came from the transmission of a 0? Epsilon is 1/2. It is 100. So what you observe in the channel output is not informative at all. The output of the channel is independent of what you send. This channel, it's an extreme channel, it has capacity zero. If epsilon is zero, according to Shannon's formula, the capacity of that channel is 1 bit. Okay? So Shannon often approach problems by considering small examples. Small examples where you can see the result. If I'm going to define a capacity for this channel, for epsilon equals zero, the capacity has to be 1. For epsilon equals 1/2, it has to be 0. And here is another example, binary erasure channel. The input is 0 or 1. Throughout the talk, I'm only going to talk about binary input channels. The input is always going to be 0 or 1. This one is like the internet channel. You send a packet. Sometimes it gets lost. But if it arrives at the destination, it arrives correctly. There is no guarantee that it will arrive. It may be delayed arbitrarily, and the protocol may just time out, so you have an erasure. But you will never have an error. Okay, so epsilon is called the erasure probability. If epsilon equals zero, what is the capacity of this channel? The capacity is 1. If epsilon equals 1/2, what is it? 0? No? Okay, so 1/2 is a very good guess. If epsilon equals 1, what is the capacity? We can be sure about that. Everything you transmit gets lost, 0. But those of you who said when epsilon equals 1/2, the capacity is 1/2, were correct. The capacity of this channel turns out to be 1 minus epsilon. 1 minus epsilon. Okay, so I wish I had a semester long lecture so that I could actually prove that these are the capacity formulas. I will ask you to take my word for it. The capacity of the binary symmetric channel is given by this formula, and for the BEC, this is the capacity. So the point is, he gave us formulas to compute the capacity of all of these kinds of channels. Okay, just like the cargo ship, channels have a capacity. And if you try to send information at a rate using a code of rate R greater than C, you are in trouble. You cannot do it. It won't be reliable. So it finds its statement, precise statement in this theorem. Consider block coding at a rate R over a channel with capacity C. If R, the rate, is less than C, there exists block codes such that the probability of error is as small as desired. So you specify, for example, you want the probability of error to be 10 to the minus 5. Okay, I go to my desk. I can design a code which is going to give us the probability of decoding errors less than 10 to the minus 5. You are not satisfied, you say 10 to the minus 15, I can do it. Okay, but if R is greater than C, there is no way you can provide that arbitrary high reliability. No matter what you do, nobody can do it. Just like you cannot carry cargo at a rate greater than the ship's capacity. Okay, so that's what happens if we try to do so. Okay, so the question is the following. It's all fine, but why does block coding work? We have no way of giving a proof of Shannon's theorem here, but we should ask, what is an intuitive explanation for for block coding to achieve such reliability? First of all, if you want arbitrary high reliability, you have to build in more complexity. You have to use more complex codes. So what that means is you have to make the number of data bits get the input of the encoder larger and larger. Okay, so for a given rate, that also means n is becoming larger and larger because n is equal to k times the rate, the desired rate. So you have a huge mapping. You have 2 to the k points in the input space, and you are mapping them. There are 2 to the k messages, and you have to provide a code word for each such message. So since n is greater than k, there is something that works in your favor. You can make the distances between the code words greater and greater as n increases, and that really provides the reliability. Furthermore, as you make n larger and larger, the noise in the channel becomes more regular in a statistical sense. You cannot have very many errors than typical. So noise becomes more regular and you can take advantage of it. So this is really the intuitive explanation and Shannon's insight into this problem. Okay, so channel coding in practice, where do we stand in terms of channel coding today? We use it everywhere. Without channel codes, reliable channel codes, we wouldn't be able to have CDs, DVDs, etc. The moment you scratch the surface of this, it would not work. Wi-Fi access points, cellular telephones, etc. And the state of the art is represented by Reed-Solomon codes, low density parity check codes, and turbo codes. These are the main algorithms, and typically the code words are of length from several hundred to tens of thousands in these codes. These are complex algorithms, both for encoding and decoding, but they are not impossible to implement. Otherwise, you wouldn't see them being used in our devices and so on. Now, polar coding. So the polar coding, the main idea can be stated like this. There are two channels for which the coding problem is trivial or totally disappears. If the channel has capacity 1, there is no need to do any coding. As I have said, I can just send the data uncoded. And if the channel has capacity 0, there is nothing you can do. Okay? No matter how smart you are, you won't be able to transmit anything. Other than these two extreme cases, the channel coding problem is different. Okay? So rather than trying to construct a code for a given channel, the idea is the following. Let's take a large number of channels and then try to create from them these extreme types of channels, perfect or totally useless. Okay? So in other words, we will take a large number n such ordinary channels. They have, let's say, capacity 0.5. You think about the binary erasure channel with erasure probability 0.5. They are all identical, independent, okay? And the dream is the following. What is the total capacity here? If n is 100, let's say, each channel has capacity 0.5, I have 50 bits of capacity in there, in the ordinary channels. What I want to do is the following. I want to create extreme channels. 50 of them will be perfect. And the remaining 50 are going to be totally useless. The capacity here is 50, the capacity there is also 50. So can I manufacture, in other words, out of those ordinary channels, extreme channels? If I can do this, then the coding problem becomes trivial. What I do is, I'm going to send data uncoded through those channels, and then I'm just going to fix the inputs of those ones. By fixing them, I'm not sending any information. Okay, so at the destination knows, for example, that I have fixed the inputs as 0, and we have no difficulty in understanding what I have sent here. It's like sending nothing. So can one do this? Here is another way of looking at it. These are like the raw materials, and then you will combine them into a large vector channel, and then split them to produce extreme channels. So this is possible, and that's polar coding. Channel polarization and polar coding is the method of doing what I have said. It cannot do this perfectly, just as perfect as I have shown here, but it does it in a way good enough that you can construct practical codes. So here is how we combine two channels, first of all. I said we will combine them. Okay, here is how we combine them into a vector channel, a bigger channel, where the input is 2 bits and the output is 2 symbols. So this is the superposition or modulo 2 addition operation, something that you cannot do with ordinary commodities, but you can do with bits. Maybe there is also a way of doing it using commodities, and that would be a great impact. We combine them and we split them. So by splitting, we take this as the input of the first channel, and these two as the output. And the second channel has U2 as the input, and Y1, Y2, and U1 as its output. So the hope is the following. I mean, U1 is not available at the destination, but hopefully, U1 is either going to be a frozen bit, in which case the destination will have no difficulty in guessing what U1 is, or U1 is going to be the input to a perfect channel, and still the destination is going to be able to estimate U1 with almost perfect accuracy. So if we do these things sequentially, the decoder is first going to estimate U1 and use it here, that estimate in here, to estimate U2 sequentially in this order. So we can go to larger constructions. So let's go to larger constructions. Here is the construction of size 4. We've combined 4 copies of this channel. And then we, in fact, split it also. Now the channels are respectively the channels that have input U1. Okay, so the first channel has input U1 and all of those Ys as its output. The second channel has input U2 and as output the Y vector and U1. So in other words, the channels have all the outputs here and the previously decoded bits. Here is the size 8 construction. And if I ask Murat Tekar Koca here what this looks like, FFT butterflies, yes. So it has this advantage because the encoding operation here can be done in complex n log n, which is a big advantage in engineering. If the operation had complex order n squared, it wouldn't be as useful. Correct? There is a big difference. Order n squared and order n log n, they are two very different things. Okay, so I want to show you what really happens, a computer simulation. So if you look at how polarization takes place, if you combine 128 copies of that binary laser channel, these are the channels that have nearly polarized to being totally useless. And then you see here some channels that have polarized to capacity 1, and then you have intermediate channels here. So as you keep increasing the size of the construction, this is what happens. So there are two things. There is a population of unpolarized channels, so we have to worry about them. They amount to a significant fraction of the total number of channels. Okay, if that's the case, then we are not really achieving 100% efficiency in our program that we set out to do. And the second thing is there is a chaotic behavior here. we don't have the initial some number of channels totally useless, and then this climbing up to become perfect. So these are two realities that we have to live with. So here is another illustration of how the synthesized bit channels behave in terms of their capacity. There is polarization, and the mathematical result here is the following. The percentage of channels which polarize to near one, becoming near perfect, is almost as large as it can ever be under perfect polarization. So we preserve, in other words, almost all the capacity in the raw channels. The percentage of channels which polarize to capacity zero is one minus this fraction. So those channels which don't polarize, as a fraction, they go to zero. They become negligible. So by freezing their inputs too, you are not going to sacrifice any rate. So here is an example of how this idea can be put to use. So let's say we want to construct a rate 1 over 2 core. We synthesize 8 new channels, and we freeze the inputs of the worst 4 channels that we've synthesized, and use the remaining 4 channels to send data. They are not perfect. I mean, this one, the best one, has capacity 0.99. The second best has capacity 0.87, etc. But this is an example. It's a very small example. If you look at larger ends, these indeed become near one, so you can send data uncoded, and reliably through those channels. This is an illustration of how the encoding operation can be carried out. So there are log n stages here and n wires. So the total complexity here, the number of XOR gates, is equal to n log n. So it's a log complexity operation. There is also a decoding algorithm of order n log n. So these are very desirable from an engineering point of view. And furthermore, the frame error probability, it goes to zero as the square root of the block length. So we are achieving reliability, exponentially good reliability, in the square root of the block length. This is not the theoretically best reliability. Optical codes, which are much more complex to decode, can make this exponent equal to n. So we are sacrificing somewhat from reliability in return for complexity, one may say. Okay, so to summarize, these cores, they have attracted attention for initially, let me say a few personal things about this. I started working on this problem almost 30 years ago. So it's a long story. And my motivation was not really to come up with a practical decoding algorithm. It was a theoretical study. But I realized, other people realized more than I did, that these codes may have some practical implications. So thanks to the efforts of many people, colleagues and so on, these codes have made an impact in practice. They have become part of 5G enhanced mobile broadband service. And I think that brought me to the end of the talk. Thank you very much for your attention. Try to leave some time for questions. I would be very happy to discuss those.
May I ask questions?
Yes,
yeah,
go ahead.
I think I got the picture, but maybe I missed. What's the cost for?
Cost.
You told us at the beginning that certain coding.
Yes, exactly. So the cost, okay. Let's be concrete. Let's go to a problem, a channel. One of those channels. binary symmetric channel, for example. Okay, so let's look at this one. The simplest one is the binary laser channel. Let's talk about this one. Okay, so let's say epsilon is equal to 1/2. The capacity of this channel is 0.5 in that case. So this channel can carry, in each use of it, in each use of this channel, theoretically, we can send 0.5 bits through this channel. Okay, so let's say you have 50 bits that you want to transmit. How many times do you have to use this channel to send them reliably? This is the question. If you send them encoded, you are transmitting, you are going to be using this channel 50 times. Now, you will get lost in the numbers. Okay, let's say 100. I'm going to use this channel 100 times, okay? So the most number of bits that I can send through this channel, no matter what I do, is 50 bits, because it has capacity 1/2. Okay. Now, let's say you have 50 raw data bits. Shannon says you can send them through this channel by adding 50 additional parity bits. So the cost is 50. You have to, the amount of redundancy that you need to put to your data is 50 additional bits. Expressed in terms of general channel capacity, if a channel such as this one has capacity C equal to, let's say, 0.7, this means you are going to, you want to send k bits, you are going to have to send k divided by c bits, okay? K divided by c bits, k divided by 0.7 in that case, that will be the amount of redundancy that you will have to put, okay? So you are slowing down the rate of transmission. If you were sending it encoded, you would be sending 1 bit per channel used. Shannon says if it has capacity 0.7, you have to slow it down. You have to bring your rate of transmission, K over N, below 0.7, okay, by getting redundancies. So the numbers I have given, I mean, you cannot take 50 bits and send them perfectly reliably over this one by adding, you know, 30 additional parities. You also have to make that N large. The more reliable you want to make it, you also have to increase the length of the cord. What that does for you is, you have a k-dimensional input space, the data, 2 to the k data points. You embed them as cord words in in the n-dimensional space. In n-dimensional space, you have 2 to the n points. So you can make the distances, Hamming distances, between the cord words larger and larger. In the meantime, the noise in the channel, due to the law of large numbers, the probability of the noise showing atypical behavior, in other words, having, for example, inversion more than what is typical, becomes smaller and smaller. So the channel basically becomes like a deterministic noise channel. We can estimate the total number of errors that the channel is making. That regularity provides the additional reliability. Yes.
Maybe I can appreciate exactly the use of the color coding. You get 100 half bit channels and you make 50 perfect channels. Overall efficiency in terms of channel capacity isn't that different. So where is the advantage? I can see that.
Okay, if I understand you correctly, this one is a capacity achieving scheme, color coding. The approach is somewhat different in the sense that instead of attacking the problem directly, okay, designing a code for a given channel, you first work on the channels,
sure.
Condition the channels so that they are easier to send data through.
Create implementation easier or? overall channel capacity looks the same to it without any color coding.
So you say we cannot increase the channel capacity no matter what we do. Okay? So the best we can hope to do is to preserve, you know, the original channel capacity. Okay? If we are able to do it, we should be very happy. After all, whatever you do here is another encoding scheme, and Shannon's theorem says, you know, you cannot transmit reliably if you try to do it at a rate above channel capacity. So the goal here is to be able to achieve channel capacity. So until polar codes, there were no provably capacity achieving coding scheme. In simulations, etc., turbo codes, LDPC codes, they appear to achieve channel capacity, but achieving channel capacity is also an asymptotic result in its nature. Okay? So you have to make this probability of error arbitrarily small. So you can, essentially you need analytical tools for the proof. Okay, so let me say this. When I say there were no error correcting codes, what I mean is there were no explicit constructions. Otherwise, the way Shannon proved his theorem was by random coding, which means you take any code. In other words, you have 2 to the k messages, and then map them into randomly chosen code words in the n-dimensional space. The probability of error, in short, goes to 0 on average over all such random choices. So he was able to show the existence of good error-correcting codes without displaying, exhibiting any particular code. So this is also one of the fascinating aspects of Shannon's theorem. It's an existence proof without, you know, showing any concrete evidence, displaying a concrete algorithm.
For the goods, isn't this...
Can you speak up?
For the goods, isn't this equivalent to insurance?
I cannot hear you.
Is this equivalent to insurance? Like analogy, I think the question is about
the analogy. These redundancies, right? Mm-hmm. The additional things, they are similar. So the penalties are the price you pay as insurance against loss. So for example, for this channel, you know, the cargo ship example can be applied here. Let's say it is wartime and then the enemy is sinking ships. So and then you want to, you know, it's a totally military scenario. You want to send some supplies or perhaps, you know, armored vehicles. So how would you do it? Would you put all your, you know, the same type of goods on one ship, or would you just spread them over several different ships? So if you spread them around, you are buying some kind of insurance, and that spreading around of the commodities, etc., various items to various different ships is like superposition in the information context, sort of like.
I have an intuitive question. What is a channel in the sense that we can partition it into smaller units and then control their properties? How are we doing this?
I'm not really splitting, partitioning the channel. What we are doing is we are assembling them, aggregating them. The channels are indivisible. They are given to us. But you know, we can combine them. Combining means we connect the inputs to each other, like it is done here, to create a bigger chain. So that's okay. So let's see one picture here. So in this picture, this is the idea. These channels are totally independent. Now you may ask, you know, you have one channel. How come you have n channels here? These things are successive uses of the same channel. Okay, I have a single channel W, and W can be used now. 1 second later, I can use it again. 2 seconds later, it's available for me for use a third time, etc. So these are n successive uses of the same channel. Okay, and so somehow I'm going to combine it into a bigger channel. This bigger channel is going to have as many inputs as the number of channels, like we are doing in here. This is the first transmission, the second transmission through the channel. But instead of making these independent of each other, we make them as functions of those outer variables. So these are now like the inputs to this bigger channel. This channel has two inputs, two outputs. This is the combined channel, and then we can split this channel into two bit channels by regarding U1 as the input of the first bit channel, W1, a new synthesized channel. It has input U1, output Y1 and Y2. The receiver observes those ones, but the receiver does not observe, of course, X1, X2, or U1, U2. What the decoder receiver will try to do is, it will try to recover U1 and U2. So the idea here is the following. Let it first recover U1. Can it do so? Under the hypothesis that you have achieved perfect polarization, it can do so. Because if there is perfect polarization, this channel is either a totally useless channel, so we are sending a fixed bit, namely zero. Okay, so the decoder will have no difficulty estimating in the fixed bit. If it has polarized to a perfect channel, U1 is random data, it can be zero or one. But still no problem, because it's a perfect channel, so the decoder is going to be able to estimate U1 correctly. Now, having done so, the decoder can go to the decoding of the second bit here. What does it have available as output? It has Y1, Y2, and the previously decoded bit. This previously decoded bit, under the hypothesis of perfect polarization, will also be available because it has been estimated either as a frozen bit or as data. So this is a bootstrapping argument. You first assume that, you know, you assume the best thing possible. Okay, so you compute the capacities of those ones, and then you, if polarization takes hold, that assumption will be justified. And polarization takes hold. We see it in the experimentation, and also the analytical formulas show us that polarization takes place. So this is not just a simulation this is a proved result. I mean, this one is just for illustration. Okay, so maybe it is not yet totally clear. For example, this bit, it has negligible capacity, this channel here. It is the capacity of one of those channels, the first channel. I'm going to freeze the input of this one because it has almost zero capacity. If I try to send one bit through it, it won't get through. The decoder will not be able to estimate this correctly, and hence it won't be able to estimate the remaining bits either. So I freeze the inputs of those ones. How about this one? Would you send data, or would you freeze this one as well? You have to freeze it because.
I freeze
everything until maybe here.
Okay.
So the point is, this one is too small. So you go to, let's say, 512. This figure is deceiving. You see a lot of unpolarized channels here. It's just an illusion. Okay. So the mathematical result says that this one is just okay. So this is a precise result. Okay. So the number of channels, I can go a little into, you know, the proof for those people who really want to listen to it. I will be here. I can explain to you, for example, what this diagram is. You have, you begin with a uniform capacity. All channels have this capacity. And then you create two new channels. These are the two capacities. And then the additional things that you do are essentially combining W1, two copies of W1, to create these two new channels. And there is a martingale here, martingale, and bound-root martingale, and bound-root martingales converge. Almost surely, etc. So the result follows immediately as soon as you realize that you have a martingale. And there is another result here, I didn't have time to talk about it. Okay, it converges, but how fast does it converge? If you look over on this side, okay, so fix a delta, okay? For fixed delta, these are true. It is saying that a fraction CW is converging to the interval 1 minus delta to 1. The remaining fraction is converging here, and the fraction in between, between delta and 1 minus delta, is vanishing, going to zero. Furthermore, here delta was fixed, but make delta a function of n. If you make delta go to zero at this rate, 2 to the minus square root n, the theorem is still valid. As n increases, even if you make delta go to zero at that rate, you still have this value. This is important because in the final slide, I showed you the probability of error, and you had this e to the minus square root n. That's where this comes from. Okay, so if it were not for this, in other words, if you only had polarization for a fixed delta, then it could not be good enough. Okay, so you need some fast polarization. And we have fast polarization thanks to this result. These codes are feasible. In other words, you not only have low complex decoding and decoding schemes, n log n, but also a good enough reliability of these codes. This is not the best available reliability. Shannon's random codes, for example, have 2 to the minus n times a constant, which is a function of the rate, much better than this, 2 to the minus n. On the other hand, the decoding complex to a random code is exponential in n. Okay, so they cannot be implemented. So that's why they are not considered as a solution to the coding problem. Okay, thank you very much. I will stop here, I guess. Thank you for coming
thank
here.
Thank you very much.